Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I welcome you to the service of today in Jesus' name. This is the first time I'm seeing you this year face to face. Happy New Year to everyone. I pray that this year will be a year of joy for you. And the joy of the Lord will be your strength in Jesus' name. This year, let the weak say, let the sick say, let the sorrowful say, you're happy. Say, I'm happy. And the happiness and the joy will follow you through from this first month to the very end of the year in Jesus' name. Today something is coming your way. I will receive. Somebody there, I will receive. The Lord bless you through and through in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you today for this blessed moment and blessed hour. We're asking, Lord, that your blessing will enrich everyone's life today in Jesus' name. Lead us in your word. Teach us in your word. Transform our lives and set our feet in the path that leads to progress and to purity and to power this new year in Jesus' name. We do not know when Christ will come. You are preparing us for your coming. I will pray, Lord, every one of us will be ready for that moment, for that hour, in Jesus' name. And should it not come anytime this year, we pray, Lord, when the saints go marching in, every one of us will be part of the crowd to move in into glory at the rapture in Jesus' name. Whenever you come, for individuals or for the whole church, keep us ready. And let your blessings be poured upon our lives today in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you. God bless you. You can sit down. As we go into the word of God today, I want to remind you, next Sunday is the last Sunday of this month, and it's going to be a concluding month, and something special is coming your way next Sunday. Of course, today is special. Everybody help me shout, special. But next Sunday will be very wonderful. And those who are to come for their combined service, next Sunday, come here in time. Get here in time. You always do. I'm just saying that because it's a new year. And something great will touch everybody's life this whole year in Jesus' name. I'm reading from Hebrews chapter 11. And we're looking at verse 13. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, that they embraced them, and they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. What a verse to start a message. It says, this all died in faith, not having received the promises. Look at verses 39 and 40. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. It's talking about the Old Testament prophets, Old Testament patriarchs, Old Testament people. And it's like they were looking ahead. They wanted to receive the promises, but their own promises for their own time, for their own generation, for their own dispensation was given to them. But the Lord was choosing a kind of people, the Gentiles, you and I, and he has reserved something great for us. And so when you read in verse 13, they died, they left, they quit, and they passed on from this world without receiving the promise. Here it comes in verse 39, and it says the same thing. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. God having prepared some better thing for us. That better thing is coming. And so when you look at the people in the Old Testament and you say, but they trusted God, but they believed in God, but they trusted that he'll give them this and this and that, because that thing was promised and it was not done. You did not go back to the Old Testament, Old Covenant, Old Dispensation and say, maybe you, I will not receive. You will receive. Because better things are waiting for the people in the new dispensation. Come back to verse 13. I'm reading the last line there in verse 13. They were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Look at verse 14 now. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned, but now they desire a better country. We're getting there. That is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to call them to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. It's the latter part of that verse 13 I want you to pay attention on. They confess that they were strangers and pilgrims, pilgrims and strangers in this earth. And the Lord wants us to understand that we're passing through this world and through this earth, and we're going to the better country. We're going to the heavenly country. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 2, and we're reading verse 11. It says, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, as strangers and pilgrims. It tells us very clearly and pointedly that we are strangers and pilgrims in this world. Who is a pilgrim? A pilgrim is somebody on a journey. We're coming from the city of destruction. We're coming from Egypt. And we're going through this wilderness of a world. And we're going to the promised land. We're going to the pleasant land. We're going to the holy land. We're going to paradise. We're going to heaven. We're moving on from our past. And we're going through this world. And we're going to the promised land. That means then we're pilgrims. In my father's house, how many mansions? If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again so that I receive you and take you unto myself. It tells us that we're hoping for that day. We're hoping for that city. We're hoping for that better country. And because we're traveling on and we're getting there, I am getting there. I said I am getting there. That's why it says we're pilgrims. And you want to be a wise pilgrim, a wise pilgrim. Who is a wise pilgrim? The person that faces the direction of travel. Here is where I am going, and I face that direction. And you are focused, and you are faithful, and you are fervent in the things of the Lord. And you do not allow the things of this world to tie you down, because you are a wise pilgrim. Who is a foolish pilgrim? A foolish pilgrim is the one that is forgetful. He forgets why he started the journey. He forgot, he's forgotten why he became a Christian. He's forgotten why he came into the kingdom. He's forgotten the promise of eternal life, everlasting life. And he forgets that he has left the perilous land. He has left the city of destruction. And then he's either slowing down, or he's turning back, or he's sitting down, and he's not making progress. We're going to the wise pilgrims in Jesus' name. We're going to talk today on the spiritual profit and progress of wise pilgrims. The spiritual profit and progress of wise pilgrims. Already it has ascertained in the word of God who we are, strangers and pilgrims in this world. We're journeying on, we're traveling on to a better country, to an heavenly country, to the pleasant land, to the holy land, to the land of promise, to paradise, to heaven. And there are 3 points we're going to talk about. Number one, sustain purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. Sustained purity. It's not just an initial deposit of purity and then after that we'll forget purity. It must go on, because who are the people that will get to the heel of the Lord? Who are the people that will abide and dwell and live in that holy place? They that have clean hands and a pure heart sustain purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. You're a pilgrim, you have to be nourished in the word of God. You have to feed on the word of God. You have been strengthened by the strength of the heavenly manna that comes into your life every day and every week and throughout your journey from here to glory. Nourished, baptized. The people who are baptized unto Christ, they're baptized in the Spirit. They are baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost. And the zeal and the fervency is there. And they know where they're going. And their focus on the place they're going. Sustain purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. Point number two, solemn paradox and peril of negligent, busy pilgrims. There are pilgrims that get sidetracked. There are pilgrims that they see something on the way and they say, hey, this is interesting. And they're very busy on those things on the way to heaven. They slow down their journey. They're stopped in their journey. They concentrate on non-essentials on the way. Very, very busy, but they are now negligent of the calling God has called them. They are negligent of the journey that they are pursuing. They are negligent of the goal they want to reach. Solemn paradox and peril of negligent, busy pilgrims. Number three, spiritual profit and progress. Somebody there is making progress this year. I am making progress in Jesus' name. Say it for yourself. Spiritual profit and progress of new Bible believing pilgrims. Bible believing pilgrims. So coming to number one. Tell me number one there in your notes. Sustained purity and preservation of nourished, baptized pilgrims. We're looking at that 1 Peter chapter 2 again. 1 Peter chapter 2, and I'm reading here from verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 11, it tells us in verse 11, dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. There's a battle. There are many people that do not know there's a battle because Satan does not want them to get to heaven. Satan wants to stop you on your journey. Satan wants to retard or delay or slow down or totally stop the journey so that you will not get to heaven. And many people do not understand this internal war that is going on and this internal hindrance that is going on and this particular personal war that is going on. Satan is warning against your soul, and you're a pilgrim, you're a stranger, and you neglect all that, and then you're toying with any other sin. It says, how wise will that be? Look at verse 1. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that she may grow thereby. To grow in strength, desire the sincere milk of the word. And to grow in power, desire the sincere milk of the word. And to grow in your focus, in your attention, desire the sincere milk of the word. And to grow in faith, the faith that will make you jump every hurdle and climb every mountain and fly over any hindrance. That faith, faith coming by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Desire the sincere milk of the word that will cleanse you, purge you, purify you, and make you ready for the coming of the Lord. Desire the sincere milk of the word. It cleanses us. Whereby shall a man cleanse his way? A young man cleanse his way by taking heed according to your word. And then it says in verse 3, if so be that ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. The grace that saves, the grace that sanctifies, and the grace that strengthens, and the grace that baptizes you in the Holy Ghost, because it's by the grace of God we're saved, by the grace of God we're sanctified, by the grace of God we're filled with the Holy Ghost. That promise is unto you. It is a promise that he gives unto us, and when he fulfills that promise, what grace we receive from the Lord. Look at verse 5. He also has lively stones. Because you are saved, you come alive. Because without coming alive, a dead wood cannot move. A dead man cannot move. If you do not have the life of Christ in you, you're not even a pilgrim yet. But it is when you realize you were dead in sins and trespasses. It is when you realize you were dead in the old man. It's when you realize that death, the deathness of this world has been upon you, and then you say, Lord Jesus, I confess, in myself I am dead. Only in Christ, the risen Savior, do I come alive. I hold on to him. I believe him. I receive his forgiveness. I receive his eternal life. Then you come alive. And he says, ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house. He's building us up. Every service, it builds us up. Every prayer, it builds us up. Every word, it builds us up. At home, you read the word of God, it's building you up. Everything you read that encourages you, enlightens you, edifies you, is building you up. Every message you are hearing as you come to the service, any Sunday and every Sunday, is building us up. Building us up, a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer all spiritual sacrifices. Only those spiritual sacrifices are acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Look at verse 9 here. In verse 9 it says, but ye are a chosen generation. That is, after you have turned away from sin, you turn to the Savior, and you receive him a definite way. Not that I'll be coming to church. Are you born again? Well, I really don't know. I don't understand. This being born again, have you at any particular time in your life, since you were born into this world, have you at any time come to the Lord to say, this day, and you know the time, and you know the date, and you know the moment, this time I come to you, my Savior. I know that I am a sinner, and that I cannot save myself. I have heard the good news, the gospel, that you, Christ, you died for me, in particular on the cross of Calvary. At this time, a moment of time, this day, a particular day, in this place, a day you can remember, a place you can remember, this day I surrender my life to Christ. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your eternal life. Lord Jesus, I believe that your promise will not fail. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I am saved. And the Spirit of God will be a witness in your heart. A change has come. There will be that joy of salvation. You remember the time. You remember the day. If you don't have any time like that to remember, you need to go to the Lord today. If you don't have any day like that to remember, you go to the Lord today, because you might be turning over a new leaf, changing little by little by little, and copying the children of God, and talking like they talk, and reading like they read, and walking like they walk, and putting your hand where they put their hand, and you think that converts you, that there's no salvation there. But that moment of time, and then the Spirit of God is saying, now you are a child of God. Not only that, there'll be another evidence. If any man be in Christ, is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. You were fighting before, the urge to fight is no more there. You were having conflict before, the urge to have conflict is no more there. You had bitterness and hatred before, the desire to fight with anybody, have any conflict with anybody, is no more there. You were a Jezebel before, a temptress before. You want to make a man fall, the urge to do that is no more there. You're thinking of heaven, and you're thinking of glory, and you're thinking of when Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior will come. There is a change on the inside you. The Spirit of God, it brings peace in your heart. all the harassment of the devil, all the restlessness within you, everything is gone. It's a change of direction. Now you're thinking of heaven. You're thinking of when he will come, I will go with him. And as things that other people can see, your dressing will change. Nobody has to, you know, sit you down and say, don't wear this, don't wear. You will just know. The Spirit of God will say, now you're a child of God. All things have become new. That's what he's saying. And now he says, you're a chosen generation. He has chosen you. Because you have chosen Christ to be your Savior and to be your Lord, he too has chosen you. Look at that, a royal priesthood. You are now a priest unto the Lord. And it is not just ordinary priests, it's a royal priesthood and holy nation, a peculiar people, that he should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That's the thing that takes place. And once that has taken place, we say, praise the Lord. A new life has come. Praise the Lord. I come alive in Christ. Now you are a pilgrim. Look at verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also has left you, has suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. All the time now, your mind is, what will Christ do? Where will Christ go? How will Christ talk? How will Christ interact? How will Christ fellowship? How will Christ pray? Because now you're following Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And then he tells us, look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 13. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 13. The pilgrim, he has a sustained purity. The pilgrim, he has a sustained preservation of that which he has now got. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 13 here. In verse 13 it says, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you. Why? Brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation. God has from the beginning of our coming to you, and Paul the apostle could see those people. He said, the moment I came to you and I preached the good news to you, you didn't waste time at all. From that beginning of hearing the gospel, he chose you to salvation. And now through sanctification. Through sanctification. You see that after you are born again, you'll not just say, praise the Lord, I am saved. Praise the Lord, my sins are forgiven. Now I can commit more sins and go back to church next Sunday and say, God, we have done what we shouldn't have done. We have not done what we should have done. Forgive me again. No, sir. You are saved. It saves you from sin. You're saved. It saves you from sinning. You are saved. It saves you from repeating the old life again. And then that's an external experience. All the stealing, that's external. All the lying, that's external. All the adultery, that's external. All the fornication, that's external. All the drunkenness, that's external. All those external branches of the tree of sin has now been cut down. And the place looks free. You look at that area now. Where is that tree? All the branches are gone. All those things we'll see here, cluttering the ground, everything is gone, but there's the root there. The root is still there. And now that's why sanctification comes in. Now, the digger of the Lord, the bulldozer of the Lord, will uproot that thing. And when that thing is uprooted, that's the second experience. It's called sanctification. And here it says, the Lord has chosen you to salvation. And then he talks about through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. Now the Spirit comes in. The place now is empty. And the place is pure. Number one is peace. You have peace with God through Jesus Christ. You're saved. Number two is purity. You're sanctified. He purifies your heart. Number three is power. The power of the Holy Ghost. If you have not received that power has now come. I said that power has now come. For you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses of it, both in Jerusalem and Judea, and then to the uttermost part of the earth. And look at 2 Timothy here. 2 Timothy, I'm reading from chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. If a man therefore purge himself from these. If a man therefore purge himself from these. You know, mothers that try to clean up their children, good job. But you see, when you transfer that to the spiritual, and you have not taken your bath, and you're trying to clean up other people, you concentrate on other people, you labor on other people, clean them up, purify them, purge them. And meanwhile, your life is not what it ought to be. And the Lord is saying, if a man will forget all the other people he wants to cleanse, he wants to purge, he wants to purify, and if a man will purge himself from all these things that will hinder him, and that will not allow him to be a clean, pure, new, renewed pilgrim. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified. That's the word again. There's sanctification, there's salvation, there's peace of God, there's forgiveness, there's eternal life, there's a ticket to heaven, there's a fitness for heaven. Salvation is a ticket for heaven, but sanctification is a fitness for heaven, that he fits you, he equips you and prepares you, and says, now you are ready. Shall the trumpet sound? You're ready. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor. He is purified and sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. Then he says in verse 22, flee also youthful lust. You see, when you are saved, you will not want to be staying around temptation, around lust, around evil sin, and then kind of dragging your feet. There's somebody there in the corner, an object of temptation, but there's something in your heart that rebels against that. That's not right. Why is she like that? Why is she exposing that? Why is she exhibiting that? Why is that man exhibiting that? They want, they're exhibiting that to attract your attention. Say, no, my heart is no more there. And then you turn away. Turn away my heart from beholding vanity. You're saved. But now, in your heart, there must still be that magnet. You remember that thing. And then it's becoming a problem to you. You go back to Calvary. You say, Lord, I don't even want to have this magnet inside me, that although I've turned my mind, turned my eyes away from beholding vanity, I want the magnet from within to even be totally eradicated, so that that should not be a problem to me anymore. That's why I say, now you flee youthful lust and you follow righteousness, you follow faith, you follow charity, and you follow peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart, out of a sanctified heart. It will happen. I said it will happen. And when it happens, what joy you will have, what freedom you will have. You'll be able to say, praise the Lord, I am saved. You'll be able to say, praise the Lord, I am sanctified. There is a freedom within. And I said, the totality of this freedom within, that wherever you are, you'll be able to say, shall the Lord come any moment? There's nothing that says, Lord, don't come now, don't come now, I have this to settle. Everything is settled. The old account is settled long ago. Settled in your heart, settled in your spirit, and settled in your life. Peace and purity. It tells us here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Pilgrims need to understand this. Otherwise, you know, if you say you're a pilgrim and you're traveling, and you have the weight of guilt on your mind, the weight of condemnation on your mind, and the weight of the shackles of sin, besetting sin in your life, you cannot run well and you cannot move well. But it is when you're saved, you're sanctified, there's peace, there's purity, and you're a pilgrim, you'll be able to move. You'll move freely. Look at this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. You know, nobody has to interpret that to you. As a child of God, if you're a real pilgrim, you know that all these things, evil, will hinder your movement to heaven. The only thing you have in your mind, because you are risen with Christ, therefore you desire those things above. And because you desire those things above, anything that is evil, anything that will tie you down, anything that will hinder you from getting to that glorious place, you say, no, it will not be. Even the appearance of evil, you're not really sure it is evil. You're not really sure it is bad. You're not really sure it's going to be so, but it smells like poison. It smells like, acid. It smells like something that is not acceptable. Just the odor, just the smell, just the appearance, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you how? Holy, entirely, completely. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithfully, he is he that calleth you. Tell me the rest. Also will do it. He will do it. I said he will do it. When he does it, he sets you free, completely free. Number one is the peace. Number two is the purity. Number three is the power. Power is coming. I said power is coming. Sometimes, I don't know what you expect during the covenant service. Some people say, somebody pray for me and I have this. And why pick up just 1% of the blessing when you can have 100%? And God gives you the power, he gives you the spirit, he gives you everything, so that anywhere you go, you yourself, you'll be a terror to the devil. You'll be a terror to demons. Anywhere you go, you'll not be looking for, somebody there pray for me, somebody there pray for me. Even standing alone, the fire of the Holy Ghost is burning inside you. I'm talking to somebody there today. The fire of the Holy Ghost is burning all around you. And as the fire is burning, all those, whatever they call them, evil spirits, demons, whatever, they are running up before you even say anything. And when you stand up to mention the name of Jesus, it will be like you are the only one that knows the name of Jesus. They call the name of Jesus, but they are not saved because they are dead. What comes out of them is dead. And because they are feeling guilty, there's a weight that is pulling them down. And when they say Jesus, it doesn't go beyond the ceiling. But you're saved. You're sanctified. You're baptized in the Holy Ghost. And the power of God is there. You mention Jesus. Oh, you say, Jesus I know. Paul I know. And you I know. Let me go. I'm leaving. They will leave. Sickness will leave. Amen. Evil spirit will leave. Amen. All those powers of darkness, they will leave in Jesus' name. You know, when you have this power I'm talking about, I'm going to read it. You see it yourself. When you have this power I'm talking about, if they meet you in the day, you will knock them down. Amen. If they meet you in the night, they're waiting until you sleep. You say, I'm asleep, but my heart is awake. You know, when you sleep, if you are baptized in the Holy Ghost in you does not sleep. And the angels watching over you, they do not sleep. And even though you're sleeping, and they come and they try to sneak in, and they want to put any hand on you, they will strike fire. And something there will burn. Look at it yourself. I'm looking at Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 11 and verse 12. Matthew chapter 3, we're looking at verse 11. It says in verse 11, I did baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Tell me the rest. And with fire, Holy Ghost and fire, Holy Ghost and fire, Holy Ghost and fire. And when that fire comes, it'll burn every chaff out of your life, burn every sickness out of your life, and burn every infirmity out of your life. And all those things, I'm not sure about this, I'm not sure about that. Holy Ghost fire comes, it'll burn everything away in Jesus' name. You know, I know some people, they say, Pastor, I'm saved. I say, tell me the story. I'm sanctified. I said, keep on talking. He says, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then I said, what have you come for now? They say, Pastor, I want you to pray for me. I said, But you're baptized in the Holy Ghost now. It says, yes, but something is walking over my body, and something is seizing my brain, and something is taking my intestine, and something is, making my blood to be polluted, and I didn't go anywhere, but something is telling me that I have HIV. I said, but where is the fire? The fire will burn today. And all those things, you know, many people, they don't understand. And this kind of Christian life, I say, but how are you a pilgrim? And what power do you have? Fire has come. Power, fire. Fire, power. And when it comes over there, look at verse 12. It says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, and he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Fire will be burning continually inside your soul. You know, somebody says, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost, and we say we're going to pray now, and I was saying, in Jesus' name, and as you look at the man baptized in the Holy Ghost, he's already snoring. He cannot pray for 10 minutes and he's baptized in the Holy Ghost. A man baptized in the Holy Ghost, he cannot have quiet time. If he kneels down like this, thank you Jesus, I'm saved, thank you Jesus, I'm sanctified, thank you Jesus, I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost, and then he's trying to read 10 verses of scripture for personal quiet time, he's reading one line two times, baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then after that he tries to pray, and the wife will come and wake him up and say, sir, look at the time, we're for work. I was having quiet time. And are you saved? Yes, sir, I'm saved. Sanctified? Yes, sir, I'm sanctified. Baptized? Sir, 19 such and such, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost. Why don't you repack your load today? Why don't you check up again today? Because that thing will not carry you anywhere. I'm telling you that there's something coming your way today that will carry you up. That will move you on. And all those things that have come inside your heart, fire will come today. You know, today we're going to pray. If you're going to pray, where are you? I said we're going to pray. When I finish the preaching, as you know, we've done this now from last retreat and at the Congress, somebody else will come and lead us, and then you will pray yourself, and then after some time, don't go home, because today power, generator power is coming inside you. The bulldozer power is coming inside you. So don't go away today. After we finish preaching, then you pray for yourself. And then by the grace of God, I don't always say this, but I'll tell you, I'm loaded for you today. And then we're going to pray and something will happen to you. This pilgrimage, you will walk free. Nothing will touch your life. And then Satan will see you, he'll think he's the old man, and then Satan will dodge from you from today. Because when power comes, authority comes in your life. Anointing that breaks every yoke comes upon your life. You're saved, peace with God. You're sanctified, purity of heart. And then you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, the power of the Holy Ghost. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. I'm reading here from verse 4. In verse 4 it says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. You see that? But wait. There are many people who are in a hurry. I don't know why they are in a hurry. Remember the Lord on the Lord's day. You remember his name. You remember his worship. The whole day belongs to the Lord. And then you find some people on Sunday, the Lord's day, they're in a hurry. Why are you in a hurry? It says, but wait for the promise of the Father, which says ye have heard. Then it says, for John truly baptized with water, but tell me now, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Look at verse 8. It says in verse 8, but he shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come. He will come after that the Holy Ghost is come. He will come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in all Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. It will happen. We're looking at 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 1. Beloved, behold, What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called, the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man. Anybody expecting the coming of the Lord there? I said, is anybody there expecting the coming of the Lord? Look at this. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself. Are you going to go to heaven without purity, without holiness? Are you going to meet the Lord when he comes without this purity of heart? Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. What does that mean? Verse 4, whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law. For sin is a transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins. And in him is no sin. It says, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. You're saved, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. You're sanctified, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Are you baptized in the Holy Ghost? Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Hey, many people are carrying fake salvation. They're still telling lies. They're still stealing. They're committing adultery. They're fighting. They cannot do without secret drunkenness. They cannot do without secret smoking, marijuana. I'm saved. Look at this. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil. Don't cover up. Don't say, I'm a leader, I'm a walker. Samson also was a leader and a walker. Don't say, I've been here for a long time. Yes, I know Achan has been there for a long time. But it says over here, he that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. This is the day. I said, this is the day. If you have been weak and the devil tied you up with the cords of sin, secret sin, private sin, that work of the devil will be destroyed today. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him. And he cannot sin because he's born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness, no, it's not of God. Neither he that loveth not his brother. Now you've seen very clearly that we need to have purity, sustained purity, as well as preservation. We're nourished in the word, we're baptized in the Holy Ghost, we're born of the Spirit, blessed in the Spirit, baptized in the Spirit. We're on our way. I'm on my way to heaven. I said, I'm on my way to heaven. Look at this point number three. This is solemn paradox and peril of negligent, busy pilgrim. Why is it a paradox? You'll think that if somebody is busy, that fellow will be on top. He's busy on this. His whole life is almost about spiritual things. And he's, gets there. But he's negligent about a particular thing. I'm reading to you from 1 Kings chapter 20. 1 Kings chapter 20. I'm reading from verse 39. And as the king passed by, he cried unto the king. And he said, thy servant went out into the midst of the battle, and behold, a man turned aside and brought a man unto me and said, keep this man. If by any means he be missing, then shall thy life be for his life. or else thou shalt pay a talent of silver. And as thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone. As thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone. Do you know that a person can be too busy? Look up here for a moment. Now this section talks to everyone, everyone, everyone. And it talks to Deeper Life more than any other church. Anybody in this nation, anybody in this continent that knows the church, Deeper Life, will know that we're not just Deeper Life Church, we're Busy Life Church. And because we're busy, we think that's the way to do things. And over the years, being busy and busy and busy has taken over our lives. Now, busy does not mean deep. Busy does not mean spiritual. Busy does not mean we're all right, we're okay. You can be busy and be shallow. You can be busy and be superficial. You can be busy and you can be negligent. This man here said, as thy servant was busy here and there, the one I was to watch over, he was gone. But don't think about the other one you are to watch over now. Your own soul you are to watch over. That soul is gone. Have you noticed, those who are so busy and a very important essential thing, they do not mind, they do not take care of. You know that you can be so busy and gain Sodom and yet lose your soul. It happened to Lot's family. You can be so busy and serve in the field and not sit at his feet. You're like a Martha, combat about many things, but you're not like Mary that will say, I need to take care of my spiritual life. I'm busy, I'm busy, I'm busy. Even when you come to church and you're hearing the word of God, what you are to do after the service, good thing, not bad thing. Pastor, finish in time. There's a marriage committee for me to attend. Pastor, finish in time. There is a meeting for us to attend. And there are people that they belong to this committee and this committee and this committee and that committee. And every hour of the day, every day of the week is busy. And there is no time for their personal life. There's no time for their soul. They're busy on the flock and they neglect their family. They're busy on work and they neglect their walk with the Lord. The work of the Lord, the work of the Lord, and there's no walk with God. They're busy feeding other people's souls and they're not feeding their own soul. They're famished in their souls. That's why you look at this solemn paradox and the peril of negligent busy pilgrims. I come to Song of Solomon chapter 1. Song of Solomon chapter 1. And we're reading from verse 6. Song of Solomon chapter 1. We're looking at verse 6. Look not upon me because I am black, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me, and they made me the keeper of vineyards in the plural, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. Look at that. My mother's children, my brothers and sisters, they were angry with me. You thought they were pleasant with you. They were nice to you because they want to walk the willing horse to death. And this man is always available. And you call him, what are you doing? Sir, I'm doing this, but anything you want me to do again, I'm available. They load it on him. Another person calls him and he says, now this is available again. I'm almost, to my throat. It's like the walk is, I'm just inside it, but I'm available. I'm available. I'm consecrated. You load it on him. He said, those who do that, my mother's children, actually, they were angry with me. They hated me. They wanted me to neglect my soul. They wanted me to neglect my family. They wanted me to neglect my own vineyard. They wanted me to overlook that I'm a pilgrim. I have a responsibility to get to heaven myself. And they made me keeper of vineyards. And my own vineyard have I not kept. I'm going to show you. Look at that now. Look at Judges chapter 8. We're looking at Gideon. Judges chapter 8. And we're looking at verse 4. Judges chapter 8. They made me keeper of vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. Judges chapter 8, I'm reading verse 4. And it says, and Gideon came to Jordan, and he passed over, he and the 300 men that were with him, faint and yet pursuing them. That's a busy man. That's a busy man. And that's a committed man. That's a consecrated man. That's a man that says, I'm going to put my neck to the yoke. It doesn't matter the cost. I'm going to do it. Well, so far, so good. Faint and yet pursuing. But the other side of the story is here. Now look at verse 24. In verse 24, and Gideon said unto them, I would desire a request of you, that ye would give me every man the earring of his prey, for they had golden earrings because they were Ishmaelites. And in verse 25, and they answered, we will willingly give them. And then, and they spread a garment, and did cast therein every man the earrings of his prey. And the weight of the golden earrings that he requested was 1,700 shekels of gold, beside the ornaments and the colors and the purple raiment that was on the kings of Midian, and beside the chains that were about the camel's necks. And Gideon made an effort thereof, and put it in a city, even in Ophrah, and all Israel went a warring after it, which sin became a snare unto Gideon and to his house. The man was busy. He was busy. He was busy with the 300. Those were 300 consecrated men. But they had no time to check up the law of God anymore, the word of God anymore. It had become busy life in religion. Think about yourself. Are you like that? You know, in the past, we used to have two different retreats. Let's say Easter retreat, we'll have session one, session two. Sometimes we'll have Easter retreat number one this weekend, Easter retreat number two the following weekend, Easter retreat number three the following weekend, Easter retreat number four the following weekend, Easter retreat number five the following weekend. The advantage of that for us at that time is that if you were a worker in the first Easter retreat, in the second Easter retreat, you are just there completely. You are not working. And you sit down there and soak in the word of God, so that you will not be so busy as not to take care of your life, of your soul, of your family, of your spiritual pilgrimage. But now we're all having only one, because we can transmit, and it's wonderful for us. But you know what we're doing now? A mini congress is coming, so that all the workers who were very busy at the congress, this is the time now, because even though you were there, you were hearing message, and you know, but you didn't really soak it in. You couldn't understand because you were busy. But now the mini congress is coming, and this is the time for you to do yourself a favor, and not to be like Gideon, and then you were doing a particular kind of work in the January congress. Now this one is coming the first week of February over here, and then you go there again, work, work, work. No. You will not be so busy. And then if anybody will call you, oh brother, you are there, you're sitting, what else sitting down for? You know, we need your attention here, we need your attention there, we need your attention there. The children of my mother, they hated me, they were angry with me, and they made me a keeper of vineyards, and my own vineyard have I not kept. And the same thing we should even do for, let's say, a December retreat. You know, a December retreat, we have thousands of people. You're in sanitation, you're in this, you're in that, and you're very busy. You didn't have time to listen to the word of God. And you've been doing that from meeting to meeting. December retreat, you're busy. And, you know, Congress, you're busy. At the time of mini Congress, you're busy. Every time, you're busy. In the day and the night, you're busy. When are you going to take care of your soul? And when are you going to prepare for heaven? They made me the keeper of vineyards, and my own vineyard have I not cared. And you look at this Gideon, what became of him? He became an idol worshiper and led the whole nation back into idol worship. Look at verse 33. In verse 33, and it came to pass, as soon as Gideon was dead, that the children of Israel turned again and went a warning after Baalim and made Beeroth their God. And the children of Israel remembered not the Lord their God, who had delivered them out of the hands of all their enemies on every side. His life was lost. His labor was lost. Everything he did was lost. Because you know why? He was so busy, you know, pursuing and yet fainting. And they went back into idolatry, and the whole nation forgot God. You don't want to walk like that. You want to slow down a little bit, you know. How do you spend your Sunday? Somebody belongs to the marriage committee, and that same person belongs to the choir. That same person belongs to, is also a local pastor of a local church, and is also, you know, looking into that and looking into this. And for morning, before you even come here in the morning, he has to be here because he's the choir. And then after the service, they're pulling him here. They expect you at the counting room. They expect you here and there. And there's not even the time to eat or to do anything. And if we say, my brother, come back a little, sit down a little. Pastor, what have I done? I want to serve the Lord. I want to die on the work. I don't want to care for my soul. Don't worry about my salvation. Don't worry about my purity. Don't worry about my being filled with the Holy Ghost. I just want to walk. Every bone in my body is crying out, walk. Walk and be lost. You are not going to be lost. That's why we'll pull you back and say, no, come on, sit down here. Some people have forgotten how to sit down. They're forgotten how to pray. They're forgotten how to take care of their own soul, because that has become a habit now, and it is eating up the very life of Deeper Life Bible Church. We're going to turn everything around in Jesus' name. And you know, all these that we're saying, sometimes people don't understand. They think we're doing evil. They think we're punishing somebody when you tell him, please step aside and pray for your soul. This activity is too much. You're dying. You're fainting. And your life is not what it used to be. They made me the keeper of vineyards, and my own vineyard have I not. Come back to first today's Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon. I'm reading that again from chapter 1, and I'm reading it from verse 6. Chapter 1, verse 6, it says, look not upon me, because I am black, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They hated me. They made me the keeper of vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. They made me the keeper of vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. Let me show you another man. His name is Jehu. Look at 2 Kings chapter 10. 2 Kings chapter 10. They made me the keeper of vineyards, very zealous and very active, but my own vineyard have I not kept. We're looking at 2 Kings chapter 10, and I'm reading here from verse 10. 2 Kings chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 10. And know now that there shall, let me look at it very well. Well, okay, it's about chapter 10, verse 10. It says, know now that there shall fall unto the earth nothing of the word of the Lord, which the Lord spake concerning the house of Ahab. For the Lord has done that which is spake by his servant Elijah. So Jehu, that's his name, he slew all that remained of the house of Ahab in Jezreel, and all his great men and his king's folks and his priests, and until he left none remaining. That's great. That's wonderful. Jehu, you're doing well. Let's follow him. Verse 15. And when he was departed thence, he lighted on Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, coming to meet him. And he lighted, he saluted him, and he said unto him, is thine heart right as my heart with thine heart? And Jehonadab answered, it is. If it be, give me thine hand. And he gave him his hand, and he took him up to him into the chariot. And then he said in verse 16, come with me and see my zeal for the Lord. So they made him ride in his chariot. I'm zealous. Come and see my zeal for the Lord. So he did all that he needed to do, but the man was busy. The man was busy. Come to verse 26 now. In verse 26, and they brought forth the images out of the house of Baal and burnt them. That's great. And they break down the image of Baal and break down the house of Baal and made it a drought house unto this day. And Jehu destroyed Baal out of Israel. Good or bad? Tell me out loud, good or bad? That was great. That was good. That was glorious. That was wonderful. Look at verse 29. How be it? But in any case, look at him now closely. How be it from the sins of Jeroboam, the sons of Nebat, who made Israel to sin, Jehu depart not from after them, to wit the golden calves that were in Bethel and that were in Dan. Look at verse 31. But Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord God of Israel with all his heart. For he departed not from the sins of Jeroboam, which made Israel to sin. What is the result? What is the reward of being busy and busy and busy? A person that is so busy, salvation is gone, and is saying, let me walk, let me walk, leave me alone. I'm very busy. And there's no sanctification there. There's anger. The fellow is fighting with the wife at home. The fellow is fighting with the husband at home. There is anger in the house. There's fighting in the house. There is evil in the house. But I'm a worker. I'm a worker. Look at the time. I promise my Lord, I'll never get late. I'll never get late. Ah, it says when you bring your gift to the altar, today you are going to be late. And you remember that your wife has ought against you. Leave your gift at the altar and settle with your wife. Settle with your husband. I'll never be late. I'm going. Everybody knows me. I'm always there. You're always there, but you're not there. You're always there, but you'll miss the rapture. You're always there, but the purity of heart and the purity of life is gone. You are busy, but you are not spiritual. And it says, Jehu there was so busy, but he took no heed to the commandment of the Lord, that all the idols of Baal, he, you know, nullified that, but the other Baal, the other one, which is not Baal, he was still worshipping idol. You cancel your crush idol A, and you're still worshipping idol B. You're still another worshiper. That's why the Lord has said, come back now to Songs of Solomon chapter 1. And I'm reading this verse 6 again. Songs of Solomon chapter 1. I was looking at verse 6. Look not upon me because I'm black. Because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of vineyards. They made me, and I couldn't resist. They made me, they imposed that on me. They said, this you must do, this you must do. They want to walk the willing horse to death. The fellow does not have time to even take care of his own spiritual life, but he doesn't mind. But they made me keep our vineyards, and my own vineyard have I not kept. I've spoken about Gideon. I've spoken about Jehu. Finally, in this point, I'm going to look at Solomon himself. Who wrote, I'm sure you know, who wrote the Song of Solomon? Tell me out loud. Tell me, let me hear. Solomon. Let's look at this Solomon. They made me keep our vineyards. They made me keep our vineyards. And my own vineyard have I not kept. That man did not keep his soul. Look at 1 Kings chapter 11. Wise man. Wise man. Wise to counsel other people. wise to write the book of Proverbs and read that book of Proverbs. A lot of wisdom there coming from the Lord through Solomon. Wise to write, wise to preach. Ecclesiastes, it says, is the preacher, and the preacher says, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Wise to preach, wise to write, wise to counsel, wise in administration. He made all those people. He said, you will go to the forest and cut wood 2 months, and then come back to your family 1 month, and this other set will go, that other set will go. He was also wise to oppress. He just loaded it on the people. And when he died, the people said, thank God the man is dead. Thank God that man is gone. Then he came to his son and he said, son, the yoke was heavy. Heavy to bear, but your wife, your father was so wise that if we try to bring out an excuse, if we try to say, let's end this sin, he will use his wisdom to load it on us again. Now the man is gone. Please, you are the son. We will serve you, but let's end this load. The sin is too much. And the son said, go away and let me talk to my buddies, my people, and then I'll come back. Come back 3 days, I'll give you answer. And then those young people said, go tell them, if they come, that the little finger of your father, or your own little finger, will be bigger than his thumb. And it's kind of a smooth you with ordinary weave, with scorpion, I'm going to deal with you. Who do you think you're dealing with? I'm going to make your load greater. They said, oh Israel, go your way to your houses, back to your tents. We cannot bear more than this. You see, this man, Solomon, he was busy on this and this and this. Look at 1 Kings now, chapter 11. Solomon. We're looking at 1 Kings, chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 1. Here he tells us in verse 1 about this man. But King Solomon, but King Solomon loved many strange women together with the daughter of Pharaoh. And then he goes on to say, women of the Moabites and the Ammonites and the Edomites and the Sidonians and the Hittites, Solomon, of the nations concerning which the Lord had said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go in to them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after other gods. And Solomon clave unto these in love. Busy Solomon. Busy building temple, busy building a house, busy building the royal palace. And look at this man, no time to take care of his own soul. Look at verse 3. And he had 700 wives, princes, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. His heart. It's your soul. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and he loses his soul? You know, he collected all of them together. 1,700 plus 300 women. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wife turned away his heart after all that gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God. Come to verse 5. It says, for Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. And then it says in verse 6, and Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord. Where's the wisdom in the man? Where's the spirituality in the man? And where is the pilgrimage, the heart to be on a pilgrim in the man? Where's the desire for heaven in the man? Everything is gone. And where is the counseling that his father gave him? Solomon, my son, let your heart be perfect for the Lord. If you follow after the Lord, he'll have favor on you. If you forsake the Lord, he'll forsake you forever and ever. What did he make use of all the counseling his father gave him? The counseling that he himself gave, Proverbs chapter 1. My son, if sinners entice thee, concern thou not. Solomon, that's your preaching, that's your message. What have you done with that? The man was too busy that he could not think that What am I doing? In what direction am I going? Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and he went not fully after the Lord as did David his father. Then did Solomon build an high place of for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and Molech, and the abomination of the children of Ammon. Likewise did he for all his strange wives. How many strange wives did he have? 700. And likewise did he built only one temple for the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He built 700 temples. The money that God provided, the riches, God said, because you have asked for wisdom, you asked for understanding, I'm going to give you that. I will also give you riches. You'll be richer than all the people that lay before you, and all the people are going to live after you. He spent that money building shrine and temple and synagogue and tabernacle for all these other idols. Solomon, be seen. The children of my mother, they were angry at me, and they made me keeper of vineyards, and my own vineyard have I not kept. Look at verse 8. And likewise did he to all the strange wives which burnt incense and sacrificed unto the gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon. Of course, of course, of course. And the Lord was angry with Solomon, because he knew all these good things, but he himself could not do them. He did not keep his own vineyard. I'm asking you today, how are you spending your life? Can we excuse you from this committee and this committee so that you go to just one committee? Can we excuse you from, you know, Monday study is there. Monday Bible study, everybody has to be there. Tuesday for the leaders, we have to be there. And then Wednesday, there's another thing you put there, which we didn't put there. And Thursday, that's for revival. And you still have your own work. You still have to go to, you know, your office and go for your company and go whatever. You have to wake up early in the morning in our city in Lagos here. Because if you don't wake up early in the morning, you're not going to get to the office in good time. There's no quiet time in the morning. You are rushing. You go there. You take your lunch with you during break, you try to bite something, and then as you are finishing work, you go straight to the church, local church, because if you go to the house first, you'll be late to whatever program you have there. Thursday you are busy, Friday you are busy, Saturday of course, now from 10, 11 o'clock in the morning till 8 o'clock in the night, you are busy. You are a mother, you have children. You're a mother, you have teenage children, and your teenage children never have any influence from you, because, you know, children, I promised the Lord before you were born, I said I was going to serve the Lord. I am serving the Lord. That's why they are getting pregnant now as teenagers. Nobody is taking care of them. That's why those boys are impregnating ladies. Nobody is taking care of them. Father is not their mother, is not. And of course, on Sunday, if you want to come to your children, follow me, be there, because I must be there before the service begins. And then after the service, now you have somewhere to go, something to, committee, you go to another committee, and then you come back at 10 o'clock in the night on Sunday. Monday you start all over again. When are you going to prepare for heaven? Who made you the keeper of these vineyards? And your own vineyard, you're not keeping. And if we're trying to reorganize, and we're trying to say, now we're going to reorganize everything. That during this mini congress, choir people, please, we love you, we appreciate you. Go and sit down there and listen to those messages. There's no singing. Well, we accept that with a pinch of salt. Well, maybe that's good intention, maybe not. But how are we going to take care of ourselves? Workers retreat, choir must sing. Congress, choir must sing. Retreat, choir must sing. Monday, choir must sing. Sunday, choir must sing. The same people. These same people belong to that committee, belong to that committee, belong to that committee. When do they take care of their families? When do they take care of their personal lives? When they take care of their personal work and profession? That's what we're saying. That even as wise as Solomon was, he couldn't hold everything together. That's why the Lord is calling us to wisdom. This year, we're going to be wise. I said, we're going to be wise. You know, even for me, you know, we finished all that, you know, all that retreat, and you go from morning till evening, and when other people are preaching, you know, I like to sit down there and hear what's going on, and then after that I have to prepare for the congress, and after the during the congress, you know, you preach in the morning, say first, second, third, and then other people are preaching, you are, and you must not doze, you must not sleep, because if I sleep, the camera in front of me will catch me and report me to the whole world that the man is not, he should retire, he's already sleeping when others are preaching. And then I try to keep awake. Am I awake?
Yes.
Look up here. I said, am I awake?
Yes.
And then I want you to be awake like that. You'll be awake in Jesus' name. And then my point is, after that, you know, we finished, you know, the Congress, the 8th of January, 9th of January, the same thing. And then, you know, somebody called me and he said, sir, our date for crusade. I said, I want to rest. Ah, you want to rest? Are we not going to work for God? I work for God and watch over my soul too. And read my Bible too. I preach to others. I need to preach to myself too. I'm preparing you for heaven. I need to prepare myself for heaven too. That's the reason why we moderate everything, so that by the grace of God, when the trumpet shall sound and the saints go marching in, by the grace of God, preaching will not tie me down. I will not be like Jehu. I will not be like Gideon. I'll not be like Solomon. As I'm preparing other people, I'm getting prepared, I'll go there too. Somebody there, are you getting there? Are you getting the point I'm making this day? Because that's what the Lord is telling us. He said, what will it be if we gain all the, you know, we gain all the souls and win all the souls? And he said, praise the Lord, our GS is energetic at his age. You know, he preaches, he's just finished the Congress now. We hear that he's also in Japan. He has gone to China and then he rushes back on Saturday. And he's there at the combined service and the man is still fresh. Wonderful. That is not wonderful. The man, you don't want to kill the man internally, spiritually. You want him to have some little time. I will not be like this Solomon. Say it for yourself. I will not be like Jehu. I will not be like Gideon. Balance up everything in your life. This year is a year of balance. And this year the word of God will work mightily in our lives in Jesus' name. And if we try to help you and we say, cut it down, cut those activities down, cut it down, cut those committee meetings down, don't grudge us. I'm trying to help you to get to heaven. You will get there.
Amen.
I say, don't belong to two committees at the same time. Let this person do it. Other people, are, look at these thousands of people. We have many of them. Feeding this one here, this one there, this one there. Lessen your own load. Shed the load and give it to other people, so that all of us can bear the load together. And eventually every one of us, the people I see here today, look up at me here, we're going to get to heaven together. I'm looking at point number three now, spiritual profit and progress of new Bible believing pilgrims. Spiritual profit and progress of Bible believing Christians. Well, we'll make it. We're looking at a first Timothy. We're looking at first Timothy. We're reading from chapter 4 and verse 8. First Timothy chapter 4, and we're looking at verse 8. First Timothy chapter 4, and we're looking at verse 8. It tells us in chapter 4, verse 8, it says, for bodily exercise profited little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having the promise of the life that now is, and of that which is to come. Having the promise of the life which is now is, and of that which is to come. Then it tells us in verse 15 and verse 16, it says, meditate upon these things. We don't have time to meditate, because meditation takes time. That meditate upon these things and give thyself wholly unto them, wholly unto the word of God, the word that saves and the word that sanctifies and the word that strengthens and empowers you. Give yourself to that, that your profiting may appear unto all. Stop there for a moment. Your profiting may appear unto all. Look up here for a moment now. You see, sometimes you've gone through the retreat, and after the retreat, people say, ah, this is the best retreat I've ever attended since I've been in Deep Island. Readiness for the coming of Christ. Readiness for a second coming. And then, After that, we go for Congress. And then the people say, Congress? First Corinthians chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. I never saw it like this before. But then, 2 days after all that, the same kind of life that we're living before the retreat, before the Congress, we resume the same old life. That your wife is saying, my husband, I don't want to be rude. My husband, I don't want to say anything that goes the wrong direction. But what is the result of the Congress you spoke about? You told me, it's not 1 week yet. Just a few days ago, you told me, this is the best Congress I attended in my life. But the way you were treating me the old year, that's the way you are treating me now. I'm just like, you know, doormat. There's no respect for woman, for wife in our house here. Anything you want to say, you never think that it hurts. My husband, look at the way you're doing. And you say that that Congress was, you, it was great. It was classical. It was spiritual. It was this, it was that. Where is the prophet? You see, even though we hear it in our ears, the prophet is not seen. Because immediately after, even during that Congress, we're busy here, we're busy there, we're busy there. And because of being busy and busy and busy, we cannot see the result. That's why it's saying that thy profiting may appear unto all. Things must change. I said things must change. You go to your office and the same dummy things you were doing in your office, the same thing you're still doing. The same way you talk, the same way you act, the same attitude you had, and the same kind of selfishness and self-centeredness is still what is there. There is no change. That's why it's saying, meditate on this word, all that we're hearing, so that this year we're going to make progress. And then we'll say, that's a pilgrim, it's a renewed pilgrim, that's a pilgrim, it's a nourished pilgrim, that's a pilgrim, it's not a negligent pilgrim. Look at verse 16, take heed to thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. It's not just enough to hear the word of God. You must process it, internalize it, personalize it, and say, this is me and this is mine. It will be yours in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, I'm looking at verse 1. It says, let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Lest any of you should seem to come short of it. Look at verse 2. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not mix, did not profit them. The word preached did not profit them. Because why? Not being mixed with faith in them that heard that gospel, that heard the word. Can you think of people that heard the word and the word did not profit them? I can think of some. Achan had all the instructions that Joshua gave out when they were to go to that battlefield. The word did not profit him. He had something else on his mind. And because of what he had on his mind, that word that Joshua preached did not help him. He said, when I saw the wedge of gold and the goodly Babylonian garment, and then I coveted and took and hid it in my tent. And you think of Ahab. Ahab had all the words of Elijah. Elijah said, see, the Lord has sent me to you, and he gave him the message. The word did not profit him. Why? Because his wife was a strong influence on him. That man sold himself to do evil because of his wife. How about Balaam? Balaam had the word of God. Balaam saw an angel, and Balaam saw the angel with a sword in the hand. The word he heard from the angel did not profit him. Why? Because of covetousness. That thing was still in the heart. Covetousness ate him up. Hey, but Lot's wife, the word that Lot's wife heard did not profit her. Why? You, angels came, laid hold on them and said, escape to the mountain. This city is going to be destroyed. But the word that woman had did not profit her because of worldliness. Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Moses spoke the word of God to them. Are you seeking the priesthood? Look at this. See what the Lord has given us. The Lord is leading us from the land of Egypt unto the promised land. Are you seeking the priesthood also? Korah did not listen, and the ground opened up and just swallowed them up. How about Jezebel? That woman was power drunk. Power drunk. You know, if you are power drunk, you want to be in control. You want to be in charge. You want to not only control, you know, your husband. You want to control Elijah. Control the nation and tell your Ahab what Ahab has to do. The woman was power drunk. All the word that she heard did not profit her. And then think about Judas Iscariot of all people. Every message Jesus gave, every miracle Jesus performed, every parable that Jesus told, Judas has got heard everything. And he was not just an ordinary member of the team. He was the treasurer. He was a bank carrier. And he could, you know, dip his hand there and pay this out and pay this out. Even the one that he wasn't supposed to pay out, he did all that. But everything here, he even had a personal word. One of you is going to betray me. Am I? And Judas has said, is it me? And Jesus said, yes, you are. I'm going to dip this in food. I'm going to put it in the mouth of the betrayer. He put it in his mouth. That did not change him. The words he heard did not profit him because he did not mix with faith in his heart. And Demas, because of friendship with the world, Demas had all those messages of Paul the apostle. Did not profit him. He still went to Circa, and then he went into the world. How about you? What you have been hearing, has it profited you? Are you making up your mind that this year will be different? This salvation that we have been emphasizing, and the peace of God in our heart, and whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, this one I'm going to take it to heart this year. What other assignment do you have that is greater than watching over your soul? What other assignment do you have that is greater than keeping your soul for heaven? What other assignment have you given yourself? What assignment has somebody given you that is greater than getting saved, getting sanctified, and possessing this peace of God and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord? What do you think is better than salvation? Better than sanctification? What do you do in the church? What responsibility do you have in the church? The one we gave you, the one we didn't give you, that is so important to you, more than you're getting to heaven. How wise are you? Are you a pilgrim? Are you a wise pilgrim? Are you going to get to heaven, or have you lost your sense of direction completely? I pray that this day you'll get it back in Jesus' name. We're looking at Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8. Here I'm reading from verse 37. Why don't you back up to verse 36? Mark chapter 8, verse 36. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? This day, the Lord is calling us to wisdom. We're going to be wise. If you are backsliding, you'll come back and say, Lord, now I mean business. This heaven, I will get to heaven. Hell, I've heard about hell. Jesus spoke about hell. It's a place where fire is burning. It will be forever and ever. Once anybody gets in there, no way, he'll never come out. He'll be forever there, suffering and burning. I've heard of heaven. And Jesus spoke of heaven. And there's glory there. There's joy there. There's no thirst there. There's no need there. And those who are there are happy and joyful forever and ever. And once endure all the temptation, all the trial, whatever may be happening here on earth, once you get to heaven, you are there forever and ever. You'll forget your sorrows. You'll forget your tears, you'll forget your heartaches, you'll forget all the problems you had here on earth. That heaven, I will get there. That heaven, you will get there. You want to rise and tell the Lord, rise up and tell the Lord that day, from this day, you want to be wise. From this day, you want to be a pilgrim that says I'm focused, a pilgrim that says I'm fiery, a pilgrim that says I'm facing the direction of my travel. I want to get to heaven. I want to get to heaven. Let this word mix with faith in your heart. Let this peace of God be there. Make sure you're saved. Let this purity be there. Make sure you're sanctified. And then if you're saved and sanctified, the power of the Holy Ghost available this morning, and it will fill you with the Holy Ghost. You baptized the Holy Ghost before, why don't you plunge yourself again into the ocean of the Spirit of God, so that all the power you need, all the strength you need, everything you need will be given unto you, so that this day the Lord himself will do something unforgettable in your life. Talk to the Lord. Don't be too busy. Don't have your mind on activity, and you are not able to settle with the Lord. Settle it with the Lord right now. Jesus' name we pray. And the happy, joyful people of God said, this year is going to be a new year. Let me see your anointed hand raised up. Wonderful. Wonder has come. Amen. Upon your life. Amen. Your spiritual life. Amen. Your family. Amen. Heaven will rejoice over you. Amen. The church will rejoice over you. Amen. Even myself, I will rejoice over you. Amen. And you will be happy for your life this year in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for your word we've heard. Thank you because you are giving us the spirit of the pilgrim, of a wise pilgrim, of a focused pilgrim, of a saved pilgrim, a sanctified pilgrim, a pilgrim. Lord, we pray, confirm it in every life in Jesus' name. What is guilt? Bring forgiveness. What is condemnation? Bring your peace, O Lord. Let your spirit bear witness with our hearts that you are a gracious God. You are forgiving, you have saved in Jesus' name. Restore every backslider. Show them your love. Draw them by your love. And put a staying power, steady power, and steadfast power inside every heart in Jesus' name. Sanctify the believers. Purify every soul. Lord, we pray it will be a sustained purity. It will never dry up. And Lord, we pray there will be new life internally, externally, this year in every one of us in Jesus' name. Lord, bring your power down. And send your fire down upon every sanctified soul. Oh Lord, I pray you'll baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire in Jesus' name. I will pray that everything that should not be in our lives, physically, naturally, spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, you let your spirit burn them up in Jesus' name. Lord, pass every life through that fire of the Holy Ghost. Renew every life. Refresh every life. And Lord, I pray that this year will be a mighty, powerful, progressive year in Jesus' name. Send your blessings now upon your people. That Lord, from this first month of the year to the very end of this year, there will be victory. There will be success. The joy of the Lord will be our strength. I will pray, Lord, you help us to reorganize our lives so that we'll move from grace to grace, from glory to glory, from power to power, from one level of joy to another, and one level of achievement to another. I will pray all-round victory, all-round success, all-round achievement. Give to every one of your children this year in Jesus' name. Confirm your blessing in every life. As we go back home, we go with the joy of the Lord. And the joy of the Lord will be our strength in Jesus' name. No sickness, no satanic affliction, no evil. But Lord, your promises will be yes and amen in every life. Confirm it in every life. Put testimony in every mouth. And Lord, pray enough provision to take care of ourselves and our families. Well, thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Another amen. Final amen. You go back home with all the sufficiency of God in your life. Thank you and God bless you. Remember next Sunday as you meet your various districts, something special is coming next Sunday. After the service next Sunday, even though I don't see you face to face, you'll say, I got it. Somebody there, I got it. Somebody there, you'll keep it. Amen upon your life.